Hello, welcome back to Let's Play Planescape Torment Blind. I am the RPG Chick, as always. We're in the Civic Festhall, and going to go into these chambers and explore these. These are not the sensoriums themselves, they're just... I don't think they are. They're chambers where people are. So this door's already open. More sensates. Let's talk to the cute redhead. Nope, same thing. Anything to look at in here? Anything to open, look through, look at? No. So no one wants to talk. For a bunch of people interested in experiences, you're boring as hell.
Alright.
Let's go in here.
I'm gone. Done.
Qui-Sai. Okay, there's a real named NPC there. Let's talk to him. This is a life-sized granite statue of a gentleman standing with his arms at his sides, eyes closed. It is of excellent craftsmanship, exquisitely detailed, and incredibly lifelike. So much so, in fact, that you find yourself wondering if it's really a statue at all. Let's touch it. You touch the statue and find that, while the clothes that adorn it are of gray cloth rather than rock, the skin is as cool and hard as granite. Okay, I'm not going to strike the statue. But I'll ask myself, or ask the statue, why would someone clothe a statue? Mort says, maybe it's a little too anatomically correct, Chief. It was a rhetorical question, Mort. Sure, boss. I knew that. Well, okay. The only thing I could do is strike the statue or leave. Okay. Ready? Shh. As you make to strike the statue, its eyes flash open and it catches your fist in an iron-hard grip. Narrowing its cold gray eyes, it speaks with a voice like two boulders grinding together. I can't make that voice, so I'm not going to try. Why would you strike Qui-Sai? Forgive me. I only meant to see if you were truly a statue. He nods slowly, frowning. You are forgiven. However, one feels you are lacking patience. Perhaps. I had some questions. The statue remains as silent as ever. Hello? My questions? There's still no response. Wait for a response. There's still no response. You get the sense that Qui-Sai might be testing your patience. Run waiting. A few minutes pass, and Qui-Sai has still failed to respond. Wait quietly for a few more moments, and then he'll answer. The statue's eyes open. He gazes at you with cold gray eyes. He speaks ponderously, with a voice like two boulders grinding together. Yes, I understand. Your patience is noted. Qui-Sai would speak with you now. Yeah, I knew it. I was thinking the same thing, Mort, because I have to read the crap out loud. Mort rolls his eyes and makes a gagging noise. Powers, no. Not another perk that talks like this. I have questions about you. After a period of silence, he speaks. Ask. Was it that you were meditating upon when I first found you? Qui-Sai meditates upon the Way of Stone. The Way of Stone? Qui-Sai nods. A philosophy. A method of combat. With it, Qui-Sai seeks to achieve invulnerability. Invulnerability? You'd be unbeatable in combat. Yes. Now, the way is not yet perfect. Qui-Sai will make it so one day. Qui-Sai knows this. Can you tell me what you've discovered so far? Qui-Sai nods. No one has asked Qui-Sai to share his knowledge of the way. Qui-Sai shall do this now. He begins to speak at length, slowly and carefully, which we're going to skip, thankfully. Listen and learn the way of the stone.
Updated my journal.
Armor class decreased permanently. What? Oh, decreased. Thaco. The closer we get to zero for armor class, the better. So decreased is good. In this, in at least in the second edition and first edition, whatever, D&D. After hours of listening and many, many questions, you come to understand what little of Qui-Sai's way of stone he can teach you. In combat, you will use it to resist and deflect your enemy's blows, improving your armor class. Thanks, Qui-Sai. I had other questions. Just when you think he hasn't heard you, he replies, ask. Who are you? I am called Qui-Sai. What are you exactly? One is of the race called Stone Princes. Qui-Sai is Genocide of Earth. Genocide?
Updated my journal.
He nods proudly. Qui-Sai's father, an elemental creature of Earth, a Deo. Qui-Sai's mother, a human woman, of noble heritage. Such is what it is to me, Genocide of Earth. What do you do here? Qui-Sai meditates. Qui-Sai also trains others in the arts of combat. Alright, I'm not a fighter. I don't think I need any more training from him. I have questions about this place. This is the Civic Festhall. Need you know more? Find another to ask. I had other questions. What do you know of Ravel Puzzlewell? Nothing. Okay, that's all I wish to know. Farewell. We're done, Mort. Happy?
All right.
Let's go through this last door here. Oh, we can go through doors. Okay, there's a door in this middle one. Well, let's go through here, of course. Back your lids and crack your bone boxes. 'Tis all a steaming something of barmy. Our slaughter and Tanari. Tanari, you're butchering. Okay, I can't get in. From the human point of view, I's not promoting one. Guy's just a crooked, okay. The sensei turns and gives you a slightly annoyed glance. I was listening to the lecture, sir. I trust you'll be so kind as to leave me in peace while I do so. Farewell. Yeah, I'm going to interrupt your lecture. I'm just going to talk to this guy now.
All right.
Sorry, guy. Lecture's over. All right, guess not. This squat, hunched old man still has the broad shoulders and scarred, calloused hands of a worker or warrior. An aura of weary despair seems to hang about him. He appears to be giving a lecture at the moment. We'll listen. Right. Now listen up. This is a seminar on the war. If you're here to listen about the blood war, take root. If you're not, you're in the wrong all and you'd best ump your soft, comfort-loving, Sigilian limber steps out of here. Stems? Mort says, the blood war? More boring than listening to a governor recite laws. Let's find some young sensates who need to be indoctrinated in the ways of passion. He waggles eyebrows in anticipation. No, Mort. I want to hear this. The man suddenly throws a dark eye over the audience as if looking for something. And further, if you're Tanari or Betezu, ump your scaly eyes out the door. Eyes not letting your ornery bastards bend an ear to this and then listen to your barmy arguments. 'Cause this is no discussion on who's right. Behind you hear the sounds of something large leaving the lecture hall. It just tells the blood war from the human point of view. I's not promoting one side or another, 'cause they both stink in different ways. Okay, there was nothing huge in here. There was just some human sensates. Game is cheating. Keep listening. The speaker becomes somber. So, what's left of your wanting to listen to some blood war stories? Tales about the war. Here to hear the R of it all, no doubt. The floating blood fortresses wove and weaved a human skin. The plains-wide battlegrounds the blood war be fought on. He bares his yellow teeth. Tales of fiends locking fangs with other fiends. Grar! Sar! His snarl fades and he looks suddenly bored. Well, let me peel back your lids and crack your bone boxes. 'Tis all a steaming heap of barmy nonsense to be dwelling on that forge dung. He spits in derision, rolling his eyes wildly. I'll tell you this, though. You can't imagine the scale the Blood War has fought on. Nothing you've seen, heard, or participate in, nothing compares. Time, numbers of legions, sheer bloodshed, nothing compares, Burks. To try and imagine it, forget it. My advice? Simple. Stay away from the big bloody mess altogether. The only thing you need to know is this. Fiends are killing fiends. Batezu are slaughtering Tenari. Tenari are butchering Batezu. Right now. He spits again. Neither's winning. Don't think either can win. Biggest stalemate this side of eternity. Thank the powers. That's it, he shrugs. That's it. I'll be answering any question you got for me now. Let's ask him a question. What's your question, Cutter? So I wonder if he'll answer all of them, being it's in the lecture. I'll start with the last one, because it interests me. So you'll tell us no tales of the Blood War? Alright, one. Let me give you an example of what meat means to them. They'll get some mean-spirited mortal mercenaries together, maybe a drop of a million strong, and let them slaughter each other for no reason at all, a pointless battle over some power-forsaken piece of land. Guess where all those souls go? Where? Their souls sink into the planes of evil they fight on, where they can be ripped from the soup of the plane and set to fight again as lemurs or manes or whatever the pike inside those little fiendish dung heaps become. The more of those sodden petitioners they get, the more troops they have. Let me ask you about something else. Can't you give me a little more on the Blood War itself? If I were to boil it down, it'd be this. The Blood War's been going on damn near forever, and will keep going on until damn near forever itself gets pinned in a dead book. The Tenari, the champions of chaos and evil, are trying to stomp the green-colored dung out of the Batezu, the champions of law and evil. They butcher each other over how each of them thinks evil should be. You can believe that. Ha! What do you think would happen if someone stopped the Blood War? You can't make any pike indifference in the war. It's too sodden big. You're a stone, a pebble in an ocean, that's a pebble in another ocean, what's a pebble in another ocean, and so on and so forth, till the stench cows come home. As a pebble, your goal is to not be noticed and sink to the bottom with the rest of the dregs. If you could make a difference, which you can't, you shouldn't try, because then the planes would tumble on down. The planes would tumble down? Why? He holds up his hands like pillars. The Blood War is like a big bloody support beam propping up the planes. Kick it down, and a lot of the planes will come tumbling down with it. A lot of baggage rests on the back of the war. He suddenly brays like a donkey, laughing bitterly. The biggest, nastiest pack animal on the planes. He grins cynically. Besides, as some say, war is great for business. He laughs hollowly, then looks as if he could suddenly cry. Never you mind that. Another question? You all right? You seem pained. The man smiles sadly. Aye, aye. Listen, Cutter, I'm no priest, nor would I want to be one, but hear this. Keep evil out of your heart. When you die with evil in your heart, your spirit falls to the lower planes, where you become a petitioner. Any guesses as to what happens then? Petitioners in the Abyss and Bator get twisted into foot soldiers, and get to fight in the Blood War for all eternity. He chuckles, shaking his head. So that's the dark as to why the Batezu and Tenere try and corrupt all they touch, because they need more troops. Eat this. Keep evil far from your heart, Burke. What started the Blood War? You had a right to be curious about what started this big old sodden soupy mess in the first place. What set the fiends to be locking horns in the first place and clawing at each other until that was the only reason they were alive. Simple. They met, he sighs. Tenari and Batezu crossed each other one day, and like two drunken bigots, they set to fightin'. That simple, he frowns. Well, nah, pike that. Imagine two drunken priests who believe each knows the only way to live. Now make those priests ripped with scales and fangs and horns and a cruel streak 7 leagues wide and put them in an itty-bitty sodden cell, and we have a good idea of the love that can spring forth. And there you have it, the origin of the Blood War. Why are two evil races fighting? I know why, because one's law and one's chaos and order. One believes evil should be nice and orderly. One believes evil should be chaos, running rampant across the plains. Both evil, but doesn't mean they can agree on anything. Bad blood, bad blood. Each wants to exterminate the other so that only their brand of evil remains. They hate each other. Like... He wrings his hands together, trying to find the right words. You see, they don't hate like we hate. We don't even know what hate is. We have one word for hate. They have, his voice drops, thousands upon thousands. Their meanings twisted and piled like bodies. That's why they fight. How does one get hired into the Blood War? You know, every once in a while, some leather-headed Burke comes around asking about a job in the Blood War. They want some jink, they want a quick stint, and then they get along with their lives. Mayhap I was one of those leatherheads. Mayhap I was a sellsword, and heard there was a little jink to be made in the war. Got me interested. Taught me a lesson, it did. We're like ants running around the heels of dancing sod pike gods. I saw big men who claimed to be big soldiers. He shakes his head. Paper soldiers. War's a furnace for them. Makes them wake up or burn. So how'd you survive the Blood War? The man's face darkens. Well, that's the one thing I won't speak of, Cutter. Suffice to say, a man does what he has to escape the war. Was that what she was talking? See, I can't remember all these things that people say, all these names. It's a good thing the game remembers for me. But a woman named Vrischika told me you had to murder your own men to escape the war. And she only told me a couple episodes ago, too. The man's face becomes red with anger. Watch your mouth, Cutter. That's a lie. Foul, foul lie. Are you barmy? Drawn with a fiend over the war and believe in every word of it? That's what she told me. I didn't say I took it as the truth. I'll tell you what happened, Burke. He sighs and calms down slightly. I was part of the company of the Blazing Effigy. A part of its original number was 53 mortal mercenaries, though only 9 of us remained. Camped somewhere in Avernus we were, awaiting reinforcements for the next battle. Well, my tour was nearly done. Then, in fact, I was to leave after that battle. The trouble was, had I died there, I would have been theirs forever. Too much blackness, too much evil in my heart. I would have ended up a petitioner in Bator, an eternal soldier in the war. He shudders at the thought. What happened? Me and 2 other lads fled like dogs, that's what happened. We scurried across the plain for a handful of days before we came to this great pillar of living ants. An awful sight it was. They jabbered and hissed at us, calling for us to come closer. That night I stole away from the others and went to talk to the pillar. This is the pillar that Mort was on, that I took him off of a long time ago. Okay, and? Ghysis shuts his eyes and rubs at his temples. I asked this pillar how I might be freed, how I might escape Bator, and it told me in exchange for the two of my brothers. He was quiet for a moment, biting on his knuckles as if fighting back tears. To me, at the time, 'twas just math. Okay. Plus, Mort told us he didn't want to listen to this guy. I wonder if he has another reason. Saying the Blood Wars are boring, let's go. Still sounds like you murdered them to me. Oh, no. No, let me go. That's a terrible choice to be forced to make. I want to get information out of this guy. He nods. Not sure if I'll forgive myself. Now I'm just a soldier who's looking for a place to die. Trying to erase the stain of evil, cleanse my inner Ghysis before I die, and return to the Blood War. I lecture here to keep people away from it all, to prevent them from ever trying to have a make, forever having to make a choice like that. I understand, Ghysis. Right. This is the last bit, then. Some of you are sensates, so I got one thing to say to you. Don't sign up to see what the Pike and Blood War is about. Don't be a barmy idiot. Use a sensory stone if you gots to know, but stay the elves away from anything to do with the Blood War for real. 'Tis just not worth it. 'Tis... For a moment, a look of great pain crosses the man's face. It looks as if he's going to weep. Not worth it at all. That's the end of this session, so farewell. And I have some more questions. Whoops, whoops, whoops. Describe the Tenari. The man nods. The Tenari pay better than Batezu, but you need to be two or three-faced and have a bunch of eyes sprinkled all over your body, because you can't ever turn your back on them. They're chaos, the ones with whim and whimsy in their hearts. Trust or uphold in their word aren't high on their list. He sniffs, then shrugs. They don't care about what happens, so long as something happens and tis evil. Mostly they attack the Batezu to keep from killing each other. Describe the Batezu. The man nods. They don't usually pay as much as the Tenari, but they don't break their written word. They're smart, though. Several hundredfold smarter. And they've been making contracts since time began. They know how to peel someone with words, they do. Sign, and most likely you'd be peeled and hung to dry in their legions. They plan like bastards. They put more thought and operation to a single strategic skirmish than most Uman armies dedicate to an entire campaign. He sniffs and scratches at his chin. They usually assemble their forces on Avernus, the first layer of Baetor. What's Avernus like? Avernus? The man grimaces as if recalling the place caused physical anguish. 'Tis inhabited by the damned and those that prey on the damned. The red-flecked lands of noxious sands and blistering fires that scream across the landscape. That was my taste of Baetor, the lair of Avernus. Terrible place. What sort of forces serve in the Blood War? All sorts. Aside from various mortal Berks and across the plains, Abishai and Cornugans, Lemurs and Nirparibo, Succubi, the list goes on and on. Tell us everything, guy. Tell us about Abishai. They're the grunts in most Batezu armies. There's different sorts, black-scaled ones being the weakest and most common. Tell me about Cornugans. Cornugans are dead ard, Cutter. It's rare to see more than a few of them together, though sometimes they form bands of elite troops. Usually they lead lesser forces like Abishai and mortal mercenaries into battle. Tell me about lemurs. Lemurs are these things that look like melted people. Annoying little sods that regenerate even as you're killing them. They're oblivious to danger or pain and so will never run away from a fight. Mostly good for dying on the front lines and not much else. Tell me about Nirparibo. I've never heard of these. Of Nirparibo. Fat little pikers that have these tiny heads. Deaf, dumb, and blind, they exist to die on the front line. Hard to kill, too. Even the most wee bit of them will grow back to a whole one if you let it. And finally, the succubi. Tenari. Lovely but dead evil, they are. They seduce mortals to try and drag them into the abyss. He nods to fall from grace. No offense, my lady. None taken. You are quite correct. That's right, he said we had to leave. There couldn't be any Tenari in this room. Well, let me ask you about something else. Oh god. I hit two. Sorry guys, I want to get to these other questions. There's a few more. Where is the Blood War fought? Plenty of places, usually the lower plains. Anywhere along the River Styx, the Nine Layers of Baetor, the Four Furnaces of Gehenna, the Grey Waste, Cold Red Carceri, the Prison Plain, and the Pike and Near Endless Well of Evil, that's the Abyss. Somehow the Grey Waste sounds familiar to you. Tell me about the Grey Waste. Also called the Glooms. He shrugs, then shivers, as if by reflex. Grey in every sense of the word. Colors burn your eyes there. They shout, or too loud. And your dreams are pulled to the surface and poured on the ground. Lost forever. Only the Night Hags rule there. The Grey Ladies of the Waste. How does one survive the Blood War? Last one. You want to know how to survive the Blood War? Three things, Cutter. He holds up a maimed hand with only two fingers. Three things. But, two fingers. Okay, go on. First off, you stay the pike out of it. Secondly, keep yourself the pike and elves out of it. And lastly, you stay the bloody pike and sod pike out of it. And go on, there's more. If any part of the war rolls your way, let your imagination give your bum a kick and run as far and as fast as you can. If you can't run, then lie really still and pray it passes you by. He pauses for a moment. Except there's no place it don't touch, and there's almost nowhere you can run to get away from it. There's nowhere to run. Why aren't there fiends fighting in Sigil? Ah, now, Cutter, look. They have fought here. A few times. Sometimes you get a little spillover from the Blood War. Our Lady of Pain, bless her steel-ridden heart, puts out the fires. Some of the time, he sneers. There's been times, some horrifying drizzle on yourself, you're so sodden scared times, when they've smashed and burnt and clawed their way through the whole sodden city blocks and sigil afore she decides to clean house. He clucks his tongue and winks cynically. So she ain't always as keen as stopping the Blood War as it might seem, see? Why don't the fiends just take Sigil? He laughs, but it turns into a sputtering cough. Don't get me wrong now. Both the Tenari and the Batezu want Sigil fierce. 'Tis the most precious staging ground in the Pike and Multiverse. The Cage is the City of Doors and connects everywhere. You can't ignore it. And if you're serving in the Blood War and want to win, you gotta have it. The man coughs again. 'Tis just the fiends aren't going to get it while the lady's in charge. 'Tis all. She's tough as nails. Her blades will cut you deeper than any fiend's fang. And that knots the fiend's stems. That knots the fiend's stems like you wouldn't believe. One quiet lady, her hands tucked in her sleeves, holding back the Blood War all by itself. He laughs bitterly. Fall from Grace says, I don't find it hard to believe that a woman can stop the Blood War. Right on, FFG. But fiends are still allowed in Sigil? Oh, damn, we'll be certain. They can't brawl in the streets. Too much. So as neutral ground, Sigil allows them to row their bone boxes without trying to murder each other. Sometimes they'll chat it up with each other here. The peace don't stay that way for long, though. Also, just because they can't butcher each other in the streets don't mean spies. Recruitment and backstabbing don't still go on here. They fight battles with lies and words, Burke. Sometimes 'tis all in the bluster and blather. And there's safe houses about, too. Places where they can cool their talons afore the next skirmish. And they like to recruit here, too. Looking for boys fresh off the plains with a little greed in their arts that they can make part of their glorious army. He stops speaking to peer closely at you. Maybe they recruited you once, Cutter. You look like you've tasted the war. There's no way for us to know. Perhaps. The war leaves a scar on you, Cutter. You'd know. And you'd know you'd never want to go back. Your temples begin to throb painfully as you consider the man's words. A memory begins to surface. See, this is why I go back and ask them everything. And, just remember, in that bar, was it the Smoldering Corpse Bar? The Tenari knew us there. They acted like they knew us. So we're gonna try and recall the memory, of course. 15 under experience. The lecture hall begins to fade from view as terrible visions begin to seep up from the base of your mind. Visions of a place where seasons are like nothing you've ever felt, or heard, or tried to shut out. A place where prayers go unheard, falling like stones to the earth. Vein-colored lightning flashes across things that were once sky, but now boil beneath your feet, and scream when you brush against them. You run at the head of a large band of men, passing through dark canyons where the walls quiver mostly, moistly, and beat like a heart, wearing only your own blood as clothing. At last you stand in a place where the ashen gray terrain slithers like a mass of snakes, coiling around your ankles and whispering your evil to the earth. You march endlessly, silently, through this colorless land where fatigue seems to live and hunt you like a shade over the wastes, whipping you with despair. In time, you and the ragged men who follow you come upon a hag sitting upon a mound of gigantic, writhing larvae, poking at one of the slime-covered things with a broken talon. You indicate for one of the men to run forward and speak with her. The hag's grating voice carries to your ears. Ravel puzzle well, I presume? I would speak with him, she said, then cackled. Her eyes gleam as she points you out to the man, the handsome one that leads your ragged column. I would speak with him, and that is all you can recall. Handsome one, huh? Ghysis says, Cutter, you feeling all right there? Yes, I'm fine. Do the fiends recruit often? He nods grimly. You can be sure of that. Sigil's the best place of fodder on the plains. Beats milk and planets all their prime inhabitants. Too much work. Any more advice on surviving the war? Aye. Whatever you does, don't talk about the blood war with any fiend, or any Deva or Archon for that matter. Just don't talk about it, period. Because you never know who in the elves you're really chatting with, and all of them get mighty touchy when you bring up the war. It's their reason for living. Yet you have sermons about it and talk to a room full of people. Okay, anything else? He nods. Don't go through any portal unless you're piking sure you know where it goes. Maybe you haven't heard tales of clueless planeswalkers stepping through a portal and ending up smack dab in the middle of a blood war skirmish. Know why you haven't heard of them? Because those sods are dead, dead, dead. Anything else? And whatever you does, never sign up for a tour of duty. No matter how much jink they flash in your mug, certain death and signing on for a tour in the blood war are the same thing, Cutter. Why is that? Chances are when you sign up, they peel you so your tour of duty is till time itself grinds to a halt. Even death wouldn't be released, because then you sink into the lower planes and get dredged back up as something worse than you were before. Then they got their talons on you for all eternity. How would you get out of a tour contract? Unless they don't want you, you don't have much chance. I never heard of it being done with mean-spirited recruits or somebody they really want to keep their talons on. Outwitting the Tenari is risky, but can be done. The Batezu are much more dangerous with their contracts. You sign one of those, you're damned for life. You might try a little garnish, try and daub them, and they might let you make a run for it, but where would you go? There are so many L's. And dying in the blood war would be an especially bad thing? If you were evil, sure. If you're good, you go to another plane to spend your afterlife, but you'd still be a debtor. Now, for me, I still got a lot of evil to wash from me soul. So if I died in the lower planes, they'd have me lock, stock, and barrel. You would go to another plane when you die? Can you explain that? Go talk to that other death lecturer if you want the dark on that. I can't explain it as well as he, though he's twice the fool and might scold you with the hot air roaring from his mouth. Same thing. Okay. No more questions. Thanks. Right. This is the last bit, then. Some of you are sensates, and I got one thing to say to you. Okay, we've seen this. Well, we spent most of the time just talking to this guy. Thanks for watching. See you next time when we go in through this door and explore the rest of what's going on in here. See you next time in a bang bang boogie, and don't stop the boogie.